Field, will there be an independent observer at U-Fly while Field is demonstrating how it could be done? That's a good question. In fact, I read it now as will there be independent observers? We have invited any participation by the Consulate of Malaysia, not because I know anything about Malaysia or have ever been there other than past the Kuala Lumpur airport, but we've extended an invitation after finding out yesterday that there's a consulate there in Toronto. We've gotten the message to the people that can pass the message that if anybody from the Malaysian office, either officially or privately, wants to attend, they'd be welcome. Originally, we'd invited members of the media to show up, but the guy who's doing the hosting there in Toronto has decided if the media wants to get a demonstration in the sim, then they can go ahead and pay for it. And he had a mild concern that if any media people showed up, they might try to make our message less clear than it's going to be. And the message is going to be this. First of all, is David around? Does anybody see any activity of David in the chat room? Because we can go ahead and pull a plug on this pretty soon if he's not going to show up. I see David's here. Ginger, would you tell David to report on his Skype status, please? Here's what's going to occur. In fact, I got to see if a certain someone, the shadow of your smile, the certain someone I'm looking for is not here. In fact, I'm trying to think of what her handle is. Oh, yes, Sherlock. There's a chance that Sherlock, who's from Canada, may join myself and the producer. There's going to be some professional people. There's going to be two professional cameramen recording this event. And let me just tell you briefly. In fact, I think I'm going to ditch my fro, and I'm going to go Anglo. Okay? Watch the improvement in my English when I ditch my wig. See, it was me all along, and you thought it was Eric Holder. Yeah, right. Eric Holder. Oh, we might want to change his name to Chicken Little. In the chat room, any guesses as to why I just called Eric Holder Chicken Little? And there is a reason, and I'll bet somebody knows it. But rather than to preempt you and upstage you, whoever in the chat room knows why I just called Eric Holder Chicken Little, go ahead and blurt it out. Now, Ginger, David, please report on your Skype status so the black fro guy knows what he should do. Yeah, that's pretty accurate. It's great that Ginger did that. Thank you very much, Ginger. And that's, oh, guess who just showed up? Chicken head holder. Well, some people would say chicken wiener holder because Anthony Weiner of New York. I wonder if he inspired that movie or that TV show, Get Shorty. Or was it a movie? I can't remember. But anyway, Sherlock can report on her willingness to show up at the simulator. I think she's willing. I hope so, because I just canceled his police grants. Yeah, scrutinizer, you're right. There's a story out today that when I'm going to call him Chicken Little so he doesn't sue me, he being Eric Holder. Yeah, when Chicken Little was supposed to go speak to 42 graduates of the police academy in Oklahoma City, Chicken Little decided, I don't know if I want to walk into Oklahoma City because they may remember the Murrah Building and they may recall that myself, Chicken Little, aka Horse Holder, that's a tribute to the Chinese year of the horse, or in this case, horse's ass. Horse's ass, Chicken Little, decided maybe I won't go to Oklahoma because maybe they're going to arrest me. Ah, look at this. Actually, Brock and I like to think of it as the Department of Just Us. You know, well, just kiss my rosy red rectum holder and bury whoever you are. Ah, Wang holder. I'd like to break into a medley of Gary Puckett songs now, but I can't hit the high notes. But I'd start with, why am I losing sleep over you? I bet Ginger's just melting. Reliving precious moments we knew. So many days have gone by, And I'm so lonely as I. Anyway, I didn't come out high notes. Chipsy, please try David again now. Oh, okay. I was going to say I'm very easy, but that would cause me to start singing the song from, what's his name? He's got a daughter named, what's her name? I can picture him. He has a big fro, too. He used to be one of those guys in that group, the Commodores. Ah, yes, Lionel Richie. Liking chicken is a racial statement. Oh, interesting. How about if people of all races just get over it? I didn't pick to be a whitey. Eric didn't pick to be stupid. And Barack didn't pick to be confused. So we all just sort of got to play the game and use the cards we're dealt. And I'm using mine in Toronto on Thursday. If anybody wants to try to obstruct my simulator, you'll want to obstruct it at UFLY Sim, which is in Mississauga. I can't pronounce it, but it looks like Mississippi, but ending in Ogwa. It's a river, I think. It's near Toronto. It's near the Toronto airport. And I'm going to be in there from 3 to 4 p.m. In full battle regalia, minus the afro. And I'm going to, in fact, now I'm supposed to call David. And after I call David, I'll explain what I'm going to do in that simulator, I hope. David Hawkins has rebooted. Now I'm going to push the CALL button. One ringy dingy.
Evans.
Hello, your effluence. What was the problem?
Computers. I think you're marginally smarter than I am, but I shut it down, and then there's a bug or a virus that keeps redirecting me away from my email. It takes me about five times typing in passwords and garbage like that to get onto the email and then into the chat room. Anyway, I'm here.
Oh, good. Well, welcome. What do you want to talk about? If you don't want to talk about anything, I was just about ready to explain in the chat room the profile that myself, and I'm still not certain. I have to go back to the chat room. I think Sherlock just showed up, but it is anticipated that the co-pilot for the Wednesday mission. Oh, yes. In fact, I got an email from that party right now. And I believe there is at least one person in the chat who is in Toronto. As per Jay's request, we need to have us and cameramen. Yes, and so there's more to the message that doesn't pertain to anybody but me. Yeah, I'll repeat that message, Anita, and what is it? Stand away again in Margaritaville. So, Margarita, thank you for that. The producer of the, I'll get to you in just a minute, David, but I want to capitalize on what was just sent to me via email, especially if I'm in chat. Apparently, there are several listeners that are in Toronto, and if anybody is thinking that they can get into the simulator, that was originally the plan, but that plan got squelched last night by the guy producing it, and that's what I alluded to about 8 minutes ago when I said that our invitation to the media to show up, the invitation to the media has been canceled. The invitation to any members of the public never really was on the table, and if I misspoke, I apologize. The only invitation that I'm aware of, and this could be changed too in the next 48 or 72 hours, the government of the damage to Malaysia as a nation and Malaysia Airlines, which I recently ridden on, and as you see, I didn't fall into the ocean because I'm right here in Plum City. Although it's raining cats and dogs, so I might as well be in the ocean. But when we do the simulator, David, I don't know if Sherlock is in the chat room, but there's a very good chance that she may appear as the co-pilot. Yes, she's here, and she already knows that what we're going to do is we're going to fly the same route that Malaysia 37 level off, and we're going to be straddling the 055 degree radial. And we're going to go out to a place that I'll try. In fact, I don't know if Jack Mack's here. He could probably figure this out. Let's see. So could any scrutinizer. I think he's pretty good at Googling. Jack Mack's here. If anybody can find the BIDOT, that's Bravo India Delta Oscar Tango, that's an intersection on an airway that made probably the Kuala Lumpur VOR. That's just a guess. But we're going to go out the 055 degree radial till we get to BIDOT intersection. And either myself or the co-pilot, who at the present time I think might be Sherlock. I have to discuss that with her sometime. Haven't had a chance to talk to hardly anybody lately. But we're going to go out to the BIDOT intersection. If anybody can find that BID intersection, tell me how many miles it is northeast of Kuala Lumpur. I'm guessing it's somewhere around 150 to 200 miles. But wherever it is, we're going to fly out to it in real time. And when we get there, I'll make sure that my hands are visible, you know, to the cameras. There's going to be two cameras, I'm guessing. I don't care. I'm not the creative person here. Whoever the FO is, and hopefully it'll be one of our own agents, we'll have our hands clearly visible when the airplane starts turning to the left to 280 degrees. And that's when we will have a brief conversation about, did you just bump something? No. Did you turn a knob? No. No bumping, no turning knobs. Well, why is the aircraft going west when we're asking it to head 055? And one, it doesn't matter to me if it's the other party or myself, because there's no pride of authorship here. But we will have a discussion where one of us is aware of the Boeing uninterruptible autopilot and the beneficial features of that device, and the other party is not aware of it, and there'll be some brief education as we fly to the west until the end of our simulator period, which is 4 o'clock Eastern on Thursday. And I have no idea right now what the conversation is going to be from the turn to the west until the end of the simulator time, but it'll all be live, unscripted, and accurate. And speaking of accuracy, I think it would be very accurate to say that Eric Holder and whoever it is that's parading around like Barack Obama, I don't know what his name is, it was Barry Sotero when he went to my high school, I think it's about time for their handler to call him home. We've had about enough of this abuse of the Constitution and the citizens of the United States of America. And if certain states like New York, which I call Bloomer Pudding, because he'd take to the rest of us Americans what type of hardware to sport around on our hips. Don't try coming to Wisconsin with that attitude, you twerp. If New York and Connecticut and states like that wish to have no tourism, continue on your no-gun thing and you'll probably achieve your goal of no tourism or whatever your goal is. Georgia just announced that they're basically creating a new policy on gun control, which is going to be not too far from if you have a pulse, you can have a gun, which is, I think, better than the reciprocal, which is the Holder, Obama, find a 30-year-old male or female in the United States military. You can have all the guns you want, shoot all the innocent people you want, but don't try coming home and getting a 22, because we're going to say you have PTSD that we gave you by giving you big, big guns to shoot innocent people. And when you grow a conscience, I'm going to name three people that grew consciousness. And then you connect the dots. Elvis Presley, Michael Jackson, John Lennon. Is there anybody in the chat room that figured out what I just said? I'll leave it at that. So David, what do you think of our plan to fly the aircraft out to BIDOT intersection and let the Boeing uninterruptible autopilot fly us for the remainder of the hour while myself and the co-pilot, whoever that is, I think it's gonna be to say, because I don't know what her schedule and her time availability is. But it is one last thing before I turn it over, David. There may be an opportunity for those of us producing this film to meet some people if there's anybody in the area, but I don't think we should plan on it because my time is very limited and we don't know where we're going to be. We know where we tell people we're going to be. In fact, when we tell people we'll be at that simulator from 3 p.m. to 4 p.m., that's exactly right. If we tell people that some of us are going to be in room 370 of the Sheraton or 370, we may be there, we may not. You just never know where we're going to show up. You know, sometimes when I travel, David, I'll make four reservations and then I'll take a fifth one and cancel the other four after I get to where I'm going. That's called staying one step ahead of the Afro Bros. David, over to you.
Well, I think it needs to be, because remember, you're dealing with the master inholders that control every major four-star and five-star hotel in the world. But here's a little sort of crossword puzzle for you, Field, and it's related to that journey you're going to go in the simulator. If you take the D out of BIDOT, what do you get?
You get British Indian Ocean Territory, and you didn't think I was going to get that, did you, David? Come on, admit it.
No, I didn't.
Ah,
Yeah,
no, you
actually,
didn't.
I've groomed you to the point of actually passing muster.
Yes, and I've groomed you to the point if I took you to the New York State Dog Show next year, you probably wouldn't be in the running. But you'd probably hire an attorney from PETA because you think that I've given you a tongue lashing, just like that paranoid guy in Arizona who always says, "What do you think I am, chopped liver?" So, David, over to you.
Be out of BIDOT and you end up with the British Indian Ocean Territory of Diego Garcia, where all indications suggest that there was a Category 3C landing, which you can elucidate if you will, field at what is in fact British territory that was leased in the 1960s to the American military, probably to the late General Alexander Haig in the Pentagon, strutting his stuff, and probably by the Minister for the Colonies at the time, by the name of Duncan Sandys, who also became the Minister of Defence in the UK. And Duncan Sandys is the uncle of Nicholas Soames and Rupert Soames, who are the grandsons of Winston Churchill. So this is totally fascinating because he was the guy who negotiated the independence of Malaysia. So we've got a very tight little circle closing on the scumbags field. And my challenge to you is, I believe you should ask the owners of the UFly service near Toronto Airport for a couple of things. One is that you want the system loaded with the landing path at Bio, which would be in the possession of Jeppesen. Perhaps you could tell our listeners about Jeppesen. And the company by the name of McDonnell Detweiler and Associates of Richmond pilot, and had it running in preparation for the 911 attack. So could you just tell the listeners just a little bit about Jeppesen and why you or we or everyone associated with Able Danger could legitimately expect that the UFly operator would have the landing strip at Bio in its portfolio or database. Over to you.
You keep saying landing strip at Bio. Could you be more specific? And then I'll be even more specific.
Runway.
Yeah, but
the runway.
Yeah, but you keep you're talking about Bio. What does Bio mean?
Bio means British Indian Ocean Territory.
Okay, but that's...
I'm talking in the with a French accent. I have a French conversation group tonight. Bio is actually, I suppose in English you'd say biot.
Yeah, but once again, you're not speaking airplane talk, because when you say biot, you might as well say you're landing in Minnesota or British Columbia. I think what you mean is landing at the Diego Garcia Airport. Maybe there's some other name. In fact, if Jack Mack is here, or Scrutinizer, or Sherlock, they might find out if there is a more specific name other than the airport at Diego Garcia Island. It's a military airport, so it might just be called Diego Garcia, but the final approach course would be predicated upon they have a single runway there, which is really a misnomer because you can either land one way or the other, so there's two runways. It's just the two runways are the same piece. Long time, how long? Probably back to the 30s. Somebody can look it up. It's Jeppesen, which would indicate to me that it's probably a Swedish name as opposed to Norwegian. But whoever they are, the Jeppesens, started publishing aeronautical diagrams and approach charts and high altitude and low altitude charts for navigation. And I believe, and you can correct me, David, but I think within the last 36 months, somebody bought Jeppesen out. But they are the only name.
Yeah, Boeing.
Boeing did. Okay, well, that opens the door to Boeing in Australia getting nervous because I keep mentioning Alison Bone. What a great name. And Andrew Peacock. There's another great, even from my own threshold. If somebody wants to know what I was thinking there, all you have to do is say, what do you get at the intersection of Alison Bone and Andrew Peacock? But let's not go there for now.
Bonecock.
What's that?
A bonecock.
Well, you're trying to go somewhere where you don't have a roadmap. That's not where I was thinking, but I'll what I was thinking is probably not appropriate, certainly not helpful to the conversation. The conversation we're having is, what is the name of that airport? that hasn't come up yet. And I don't know what the purpose is, but our agent Telstar, Austin, Texas, where in 1993, Susie Bogus sang Aces, "Oh, I don't know, might be true. You know, I've always wanted what's best for you." Anyway, there's a line in that song, "Don't deal me the aces and expect I will not play." And that's what my sister's done here. My sister has been so all over the place in this criminal, evil quagmire called Washington, D.C., world's greatest depository of excrement. Anything. I keep coming back to us, David, because Abel Danger's everywhere. Same thing, my sister's everywhere. She's at the Department of Justice, she's at NAPAWASH, she's at NSA, of her relationships to NAPAWASH and NSAWW and Senior Executive Services. They're all getting scrubbed, and I think maybe it's time to do a rubby-dub-dub and scrub the three in the tub, those three being Chicken Little, what's his name, and Christine Marcy. So did I answer your question at all about the final approach to the Diego Garcia runway? Because we will do a Category 3C landing there, whether it's set up for it or not. It's possible to do one even if they're not set up. It's illegal to do one if they're not set up. But that's one of the great conundrums for professional airline pilots for the last 20 years, is if you try to do everything safely and legally, you might not be able to accomplish that. But as far as the legally, I haven't met a passenger yet that gives a rip about rules, but they sure like to arrive at their destination in one piece, have their luggage, and not be crawling through sheet metal to find their way out of the aircraft. David, over to you.
Yeah, well, the crunch comes, and I'll just read this. MDA, that's McDonnell Detweiler and Associates of Richmond, British Columbia, which is the company I notified the head of security, the British Royal Navy, had been taken over by organized crime in the year 2000, if not before, and he wrote back to me or emailed back to me, "Stop talking to us, we don't know who you are." And then McDonnell Detweiler promptly navigated the USS Cole, the most advanced frigate in the United States Navy, into Aden Harbor in a nearly successful attempt to blow it into a million pieces. Anyway, by the by, MDA, to provide information products for aviation safety to Jeppesen. And this is a press release by McDonnell Detweiler of April the 1st, 2003, which I'd like how McDonnell Detweiler and the Canadian government is trying to fool Americans. Richmond, BC, McDonnell Detweiler and Associates announced today that the company's Geographic Information Products Group has signed a multi-year contract with Jeppesen, a subsidiary of Boeing Commercial Aviation Services, to provide a geographic information database for hundreds of airports around the world. Now, apparently, Detweiler got a contract with the United States Air Force to provide its instrument approach procedure and final approach procedure services to 108 air forces used by the United States Air Force around the world, which I would assume to be including the Diego Garcia Airport. The first phase of the five-year contract requires MDA to deliver the initial airport information over the next 12 months. It includes the option for MDA to provide regular data updates and add new airports over the next 4 years. So I would think, Phil, if this came out on April Fool's Day 2003, by now McDonnell Detweiler has provided that kind of information for every significant airport used by the United States in Air Force One, flying under the rubric of the National Command Authority. McDonnell Detweiler will use Digital Globe's high-resolution QuickBird satellite imagery to produce the information, including positions of runways and taxiways at 289 airports, so that airlines can increase aviation safety and provide minimum cost routing from touchdown to gate. Now, here's a dilemma for any pilot flying any significant aircraft into any significant airfield around the world. If they're using Jeppesen and the McDonnell Detweiler service, McDonnell Detweiler can digitally insert an obstacle that triggers the collision, now the TCAS warning. So could you just do a riff on the possibility, for example, that McDonald et Vianney could insert an obstacle into the Jeppesen digital maps of those runways that might have caused the maneuver that we saw at San Francisco Airport. Field, over to you.
Tried to hitch a ride to San Francisco. Anyway, are you talking about Asiana 214 crashing at San Francisco in July of last year, David? Is that your question?
Yeah. Yes.
I don't think it crashed. I think that, first of all, that runway had been shut down. The runway in question was 28 left. It had been shut down for, and according to a trusted agent that's in the chat room right now, who may wish to appear and make a comment, but the airframe that was shown to be nearly destroyed at San Francisco, that airframe was taken out of service the day before because it had reached its cycle life. What cycle life means, a cycle is a takeoff, a pressurization. What that means is the aircraft cycles strength-wise as it goes up. The aircraft is surrounded by decreased pressure, and the pressure on the inside of the aircraft is such that it's maintained at a fairly consistent differential. So the aircraft will actually expand as it goes up. And if you want to practice this, what you can do is next time any of you go on an airplane ride, take a empty bottle, and I say empty because they won't let you take bottles with liquid. If you take an empty bottle, like let's say a Sprite or a 7-Up bottle, and you pour all the liquid out and you put the cap on tight, as you go up, the pressure inside that bottle is going to increase vis-a-vis the pressure on the outside of the bottle. And then if at the top of your climb, when the captain takes the cap off, and you'll hear air rush out, the air that was under pressure. The better demonstration is up at 35,000 feet. Take the cap off the bottle, let it stabilize, then put the cap back on the bottle very tightly, and then watch what happens to that pop. And when I say bottle, I mean plastic bottle. If you do this with glass, nothing will happen. But with a plastic bottle, as you descend from the, let's say, 35,000 feet to the all the way down, and the bottle itself is going to collapse and it'll be crushed by pressure. That wasn't your question. In fact, what was your question, David? It had something to do about airplanes.
Well, I'm trying to get you to explain what would happen if McDonald Detweiler or Serco inserted a digital obstacle on the landing approach by an aircraft using these Jeppesen maps.
Well, that's a little complex for me, since I just woke up a couple hours ago. I don't really understand the question, so I'll answer it in a different way. What if they decided they wanted to create an incident, and they went out, say, on a 14-foot fishing boat on the extended center line of runway 28 left, and they had a helium balloon, and they saw an airplane coming on approach to 28 left, and they're about, let's say their 1200 was of sufficient lift capability that it could lift a TCAS transmitter up into the air. That would simulate having an aircraft sitting there 1200 feet off the runway, say at 60 feet. And what you would see is if the aircraft approaching 28 left, it would start to get guidance from its own TCAS, because the way TCASs work, here you go. Here comes the white airplane into San Francisco, which, say, San Francisco's airport is my right hand. That's this hand. And Shaker is the boat with a suspended TCAS, battery-operated TCAS, and it's sitting there stationary. As this airplane got to about 6 miles, the TCASs would be talking to each other, and this aircraft TCAS would point out an impending too close for comfort dynamics, and the series of suggestions would change from color to color as the urgency or the pilot action to avoid a collision became more significant. The TCASs are based on lots of things, but in simplest terms, it's based on the computations between the two cooperating TCASs to determine their closure in knots. And if the closure in knots, say they're both going 500, which is 480 knots, which is 8 miles a minute. So is that right? No, that's not right. 480 knots, it is 8 miles a minute. Who gives a rat's ass? Anyway, these airplanes are approaching at 500 knots. Well, they're going to start giving TCAS warnings at a much greater distance because the closure time is measured in seconds or minutes. Now, on the other hand, if the airplanes were following one behind the other, and this one's going 450 and this one's going 480, you could sneak up pretty close because the relative airspeed is only 30 knots, so the time to react is much greater. The TCASs will give you advisories, and they will also give you commands. And the commands, when a TCAS is telling the pilot to do something, what will happen is in their vertical speed, I wish I had something that could look like a vertical. Yeah, this would look like a vertical speed. This is a vertical speed indicator. And regardless of what the pilot is descending at about 700 feet per minute, and then, so now we're looking at the VSI pointing down 700 feet per minute. And then when it sees that other TCAS suspended above the 14-foot boat, it's going to say decrease rate of descent with an amber warning. And it's going to continue to say decrease and decrease. Then it's going to say climb. And then if it wants you to climb really fast, and what it wants you to do is to disconnect the automation or to push the go-around button, either or. And the pilot is required, there's going to, if his descent was here at 700 feet and the TCAS thinks you need to climb 1500 feet to avoid the conflict, the warning will change from amber to red, and it'll go up here to 1500 feet, and it'll say you have to climb 1500 feet or you're going to collide with this thing. So the pilot at that point could either disconnect the autopilot, manually rotate the aircraft to 1500 feet per minute climb or more, climb to, and if it didn't go to 1500 feet or more, then you'd have no choice but to override the automation. And it's illegal not to comply when the TCAS turns red and tells you to climb to avoid conflict. That's a euphemism for crash. You have to do it, and you don't have to tell anybody. It's better for everybody if once you've complied with the TCAS. And what it's going to look like, it's going to go from down here, green, and then it's going to, when it starts seeing a problem, it'll be amber. And then when it sees a big problem, it'll turn red. The co-pilot or anybody that's up there alive has to rotate the aircraft to comply with this red arrow. And once you go past the red arrow, it'll turn green again because you're safe. All this stuff is built to enhance safety. You want me to say something that's pretty ugly, David?
Absolutely.
Yeah, all this crap that is supposed to replace pilot thinking in the interest of safety, it can all be used against people. And we just saw that with Malaysia 370, where a benign facility, it's benign, the autopilot, and I've got patents, and it's not like I have patents, they're public patents, but I've got them collected in the last couple chapters. And they had patent activity starting in 1970 that has led to the most recent patent I've seen, which is 2013, where they've been constantly upgrading and improving and making safer the Boeing uninterruptible autopilot. But unfortunately, there's some back doors in that situation. And because aviation in and of itself is so inherently safe, they can't really scare people anymore by saying some terrorists are going to hijack your airplane because the terrorists can't get in the cockpit. And if they got in the cockpit, it would do them no good because the Boeing uninterruptible autopilot could be triggered by the pilots if the pilots only knew it was there, which they don't, which is a huge problem. The big, huge problem is when the truth of the Boeing uninterruptible autopilot becomes commonplace, somebody's going to start talking about it in the mainstream media. And when they do, the passengers and the pilots alike are going to be reluctant to get on any Boeing uninterruptible autopilot aircraft because, let me just rattle off the top of my head, 9 aircraft that have crashed using the Boeing uninterruptible autopilot. And the terrorists today are not bearded Muslims. They tend to be people within our own government that want to confuse, cause chaos, terrify, and get all of us Americans begging for more security. I would think we could enhance our security a thousandfold if Eric Holder, whoever he is at 1600, Christine Marcy, Dianne Feinstein, and perhaps either Judge Roberts or John McCain were incarcerated. That would be a good, the mid-50s until the late 80s, was the U.S. military was so powerful, it had no natural enemies. And so you either had to create some enemies that are unnatural, or you had to decrease the potency of the United States military, which has been consistently done going back to the very late 80s. And who would benefit from the U.S. military being weakened? The central bankers. Because when the U.S. military was a force nobody could defeat, the bankers really have a hard time getting big wars going. But yet, as you draw down the U.S. military and you build up other militaries that might not be friendly to the U.S. military, Israel, Russia, China, pick an enemy. Now we do have unnatural enemies, and it seems that they're all concentrated in the Washington, D.C. Beltway. So do you think that's accurate, or do you think I'm off in Never Never Land, David?
No, you're absolutely accurate. And of course, the idea that Bill Clinton had of instructing the chairman of his Joint Chiefs of Staff to go to China and give a lecture in Beijing and leave behind the details of all America's weapon systems is a pretty good boost for the assumed end of getting ahead of America in terms of its advanced technology, including stealth. But just going back to that TCAS command, am I correct in understanding, if I've listened to you carefully, is that the TCAS can signal to an otherwise innocent plane, can be spoofed digitally, such that the plane might, or the plane's pilot might be forced to go through maneuvers that at that particular speed or elevation will result in a fatal crash, as in Air France 447. Over to you.
Yeah, I wasn't listening because I was responding. I'll answer your question even though I didn't listen to it because I know where you were going. Joy S. said, did Field give the answer to the link of those three singers, Michael Jackson, John Lennon, and Elvis Presley? Yeah, what they had in common was they all had developed social consciences. Elvis Presley wanted to get out of rock and roll and do gospel singing. And the powers that be that have been creating the moral, well, probably the mid-60s, that moral decay has been facilitated to some degree by popular music. And John Lennon of the Beatles was, I think, when he died in October of 1980 at the Dakota apartment building in New York City, I think he'd been contemplating giving an honest history of who it was that bankrolled the Beatles and basically crammed them into the minds of young enough that probably wasn't in the best interest of the young people themselves, or certainly families, or normal relationships between males and females. But, you know, that's history, and that's 34 years ago, 1980 to 2014. Yep, my computer still works. It's 34 years ago. Michael Jackson, social conscience there. Some people say, how can he have a social conscience? Well, I'm not sure in his case if he was developing a social conscience, but he had some financial problems due to that house and some of his overnight guests. And he was offered relief from his financial problems by some fellow in either Yemen or Oman, somebody knows, but some oil-rich sheik had told Michael, I will pay off your debts if you, and you will let the people at your concerts know that 9/11 and these other anti-Muslim propaganda events are not accurate. Strangely enough, must have accepted that as a condition to get his debts paid off, but he didn't last long, did he? And he never performed those concerts. So, David, you were asking about, could a corrupt signal be transmitted Or could it be received by Air France 447? And so let me back up. I'll give you the short answer. Yep. Yep is the short answer. But here's, it gets more critical than that. Just like MH370 was allegedly lost at the deepest part of that ocean, which, by the way, it wasn't lost. It's never been lost. They've known since it landed safely on March 8th. Having said that, Air France, strangely enough, went down over the deepest part of the ocean on a route from Rio de Janeiro to Paris. That's one thing, deep water. Another thing was they know legally that the captain has to be out of the cockpit for X number of hours. The X is determined by taking 8 hours and subtracting from the length of the flight. If the length of a flight is, well, I just flew one from Malaysia, it was 1240. So a 12-hour and 40-minute flight, the captain has to be out of his seat for at least 4 hours and 40 minutes because he can't be in a duty status for more than 8 hours. These rules are made by lawyers, and it's all a bunch of crap. When I flew three-seat, in other words, pilot, co-pilot, engineer, DC-10s, we could fly for a long, long time. When they improved the DC-10 and made it an MD-11, so you only have two pilots, boom. Now you, same pilots, they can't fly for a long, long time. They can only fly for 8 hours. I don't miss the airline business. When I started in the airline, to be somewhere, the rationale has all changed and I'm confused by it. But here we go, I'm gonna set this up. Here comes Air France 447. The captain's in the CRF crew rest facility. Some cardiopulmonary exercise with his travel mate, who is a female, thank God. But anyway, he allegedly had a little girlfriend along on this flight, which I guess those things happen. So he's back there in the CRF doing whatever it is captains do in the CRF. I wouldn't know. And then here comes a thunderstorm, okay? And hanging around the thunderstorm, which is directly over the deepest part of the ocean, while the captain's back there in the CRF, thunderstorms are to be avoided. Everyone knows that. You can avoid them laterally or you can avoid them horizontally. In this case, the two co-pilots who, I have to choose my words fairly carefully, but I don't think Air France pilots need, because these guys were pretty low-time co-pilots. So you take two low-time co-pilots, you get them in a scary situation at night where they have to try to get over the top of a thunderstorm, and there's a thing called stall margin. As you're higher and higher and heavier, the stall margin shrinks. Okay, these two fingers, which reminds me, this one's really sore because a goat injured me 2 days ago. Anyway, the stall margin here, let's say at 3,000 feet, the slow speed stall might be 140 knots and the high speed stall might be 500 knots. As you go higher and higher and higher and higher and higher, up at the top of your flight capability, and let's just say that Air France was operating, I don't know if it was 350 or 370, but I'm going to pick one. Let's say they were at 370 trying to top this thunderstorm, and the top of the thunderstorm was at 38 or 39,000. Now they're not going to top it. Okay, but they've gotten themselves at the extreme of their altitude capability where their stall margin, let's say they're going 0.8 Mach. If they slow up to 0.75 Mach, they're going to get a slow speed stall. If they go to 0.83 Mach, they're going to get a high speed stall. Now, these are not accurate, but I'm using them to show you how the narrow the margin is at the extreme altitude capability of any aircraft. Okay, so here comes Air France. The captain's still back doing whatever he's doing in the CRF. The co-pilots are sitting there. They're trying to get on top, get over the thunderstorm. Anybody know what's in a thunderstorm at the top? Well, I'll tell you what's in there. Moisture and cold air. Moisture and cold are cooled, like the nose of the aircraft or like the pitot tubes. If the pitot tubes, and let me show you what a pitot tube looks like. There's three of them on these aircraft, and they're forward-facing devices where this is hollow. Now, of course, this is not hollow, it's plastic, but wait a minute, I can make it hollow, can't I? There we go, now it's hollow. Okay, so this is a pitot tube. And as it goes rushing through the air, metric type device that says, I'm getting enough pressure in here that I think we're going 480 knots. Okay, right next to it, down low, is the auxiliary pitot tube, which looks exactly like the captain's pitot tube. And it says, the pressure coming through this opening causes me to think we're going 480 knots. Okay, now we're going to move over to the co-pilot side. The FO's indicator, suddenly the heat is turned off to the indicator. It gets iced up and it's registering no airspeed. So it communicates with the other two. It says, hey, you guys, I don't know how fast you're going, but I also don't know how fast I'm going. So take me out of the calculation. So the automation will balance the captain's pitot tube and the aux pitot tube, and it'll take the it'll average those values. And then let's say one of them says 482 knots, one says 480 knots. It'll display on both the pilot and the co-pilot's navigational displays, which are great big CRTs, cathode ray tubes, I think that's what they're called. It'll balance an average. It'll say we're going 481 knots. Okay, that's good. We're going 481 knots. Okay, we're getting closer to this thunderstorm. Uh-oh, now we're in the thunderstorm. We can't turn to avoid it, because if you turn, the stall margin's going to get you. And if you try to climb, the stall margin's going to get you. So there's nothing to do in their mind, and their lack of experience, than to go plowing through this thunderstorm at whatever altitude they were at. And in the case of this, I had said they were at 370. Okay, something that was not in their mind. If you're going to go in there and get iced up anyway, there's really no great advantage on having a stall margin of, say, 8 knots. If you descend to 350 or 330, you're going to increase your stall margin. Why would that be prudent? Anybody ever heard of turbulence? When you get into turbulence, the airspeed of the aircraft is going to change as the vertical velocity of the air itself is moving around. So you don't want to be sitting at, they call that coffin corner, C-O-F-F-I-N. You don't want to be sitting at a no margin airspeed if the air itself is going to start moving you around. So what you got is you got two inexperienced co-pilots. You got one pitot tube that already says, hey, I don't know what we're doing. Okay, now when you get into the clouds and you get into the moisture and the super cooled air, a second pitot tube goes out. And when I turn this over to you, David, I will go get it if somebody, oh, wait a minute, somebody already had it. Look at this. I would say, oh, you did. David, good for you. These are the TCAS warnings, and I think they're, am I correct, David, in thinking that the top one indicator, ISIS, is the first thing you found, and the rest of them are ordered?
Yeah, that's in time order.
Oh, okay, good. So this is what the co-pilots were looking at, and every time they got a new one of these, for instance, when they had indicator ISIS, it would, and that's not ICES, that's ISIS, they would have heard a ding, and that causes them to look down and see an amber warning that says ISIS. Then they hear another ding, and that's traffic and terrain collision avoidance system. That's the one that you were interested in. That's the ACARS. Okay, now how could that have been triggered? But keep in mind that they're up, I forgot which one's which. That's pitot tubes. Here's Air France. They're running out of airspeed and altitude at the same time. And suddenly, as they're in the worst possible dynamic of the entire flight from Rio de Janeiro to Paris, they're at the top of their altitude capability. They have a very small stall margin. They lose two indicators of airspeed, which throws all the automation in the garbage bag. And then, let's say a little Canadian CRJ flown by Russell Williams would intentionally encroach on their airspeed, excuse me, their airspace. If somebody, it could be anybody, but just for the sake of argument, let's say it was the Canadian Stallion Russell Williams in a CRJ, and he could have launched that CRJ from the Falklands or anywhere. Who cares? Doesn't matter. It's all conjecture and hyperbole, whatever that means. Okay, you get some rogue player that intentionally crowds your airspace. Now the TCAS is going to say, we have a problem. And then it's either going to say climb, descend. And if it says climb, those young pilots with no experience are going to try to climb. There's nothing legal about crashing. If your action to be legal is going to cause you to die, you got your head up your rear end. Not to be critical of the French co-pilots, but I will be critical of Air France. You shouldn't be having low-time co-pilots flying any time that you might need more experience, seat-of-the-pants type experience, to salvage the aircraft, the passengers, and the crew. So, David, in order, the next thing is the air traffic control TCAS thing went off, and then the IRUs, and that stands for Air Data Inertial Reference System. Both of those went out. These guys are running out of really important crap. Electrical flight control system. That's not good. Flight management guidance, FMGC, that's what tells you what to do. It's gone. Flight envelope computation. Okay, you remember the margin, the stall margin I was talking about with my fingers? Okay, that's flight envelope, stall margin, same difference to laymen like me. Okay, now it's saying, well, you know, suddenly I can't figure that out either, so you guys are on your own. That's what the system's saying. Okay, auto thrust. When auto, my beeper just went off, but when auto thrust goes off, what it's telling you is I can no longer control the speed of the aircraft, and I can no longer keep it within the confines of the stall margin or the flight envelope. And even if I could, I don't know what the flight envelope is, so I'm going to do you guys a favor, and I'm going to turn myself off. Now you fly the throttles. And these guys don't have the experience to do that. That's my opinion. Next, we have rudder and pedal travel limiting actuation. Interesting. Anybody remember that Airbus that went into Jamaica, New York, because the tail came off? Well, here's how the tail comes off. When the automation's working, it knows how fast you're going, and on the very back of the vertical fin of a aircraft, there's a movable object or numerous objects called the rudder or rudders. Well, if you're going 500 knots, your rudder authority is going to be about this minimal, okay? If you're at 130 knots on final approach, you have full travel of your rudder. Okay, when the aircraft gets confused and all the automation is scratching its head and saying, I don't have a blanking clue as to what's going on up here, it's going to tell the rudder, Mr. Rudder, you do whatever you want because we've lost our grip and we don't know what we're doing. Okay, that means now you're going 500 knots at the top of a thunderstorm. Wham, the rudder could go full travel. If it did, it would do two things, potentially. If the aircraft stayed intact, the rudder going full travel would cause you to stall as the airflow over all the airfoils, all the airflow would be disturbed because you're going to go like this abruptly, one way or the other. And let's just, for the sake of argument, go this way abruptly. Okay, that's going to create vast amount of lift on this wing, and it's going to create a loss of lift on the other wing. Okay, remember we're at our stall margin of very little? Okay, then when you do this, you're going to stall. And we didn't even get to the bottom of this yet. Probe pedal, okay, rudder pedal, yeah, flight control primary. The flight controls computer is saying, I don't know how to control this airplane. You two low-time co-pilots have to do it. Then the probe pedal, that's what I iced up. Remember I said, I don't know how fast I'm going? You guys figure it out? That's what that is. Flight control primary computer, yep, that's saying you humans have to fly. Pressure control and monitoring. Operational configuration. Oh, this is significant. Over there in parentheses, it says flight control alternate law. Somebody could probably pull it up, but there's a escalation or a degradation of flight control protections in the Airbus system. And there's a normal law, then alternate law, and then there's a third law, which is even worse than alternate law. But as you go down from, I think a way a layman would figure this, is full capacity of everything to alternate capacity, and then standby capacity, and then you're dead. That's basically in layman's terms what this is talking about. So these guys, the two co-pilots, they lost all the automation. The captain's back there doing whatever he's doing in the CRF. Suddenly they have no stall protection, they have no experience, and if they had experience, it's really hard to do this without sounding like a raging egomaniac. But if they had experience, they would have, long before they got all these degradations, they would have descended even if you can't get clearance to descend, the aircraft doesn't know if you've called and requested clearance or not, and the aircraft doesn't give a rat's ass. So what an experienced guy would do is two things. Put the nose down because you want to get some more stall margin, and if you're concerned with hitting somebody, then just turn off course 15 degrees and you'll be separating from the tracks. What I mean by tracks, all across the North Atlantic, every day and every night, there are geographical tracks, so everybody's basically on the same custom airways built for the existing winds on that day in history. And this, none of this crap is difficult. None of it is rocket science, but also none of it is factory installed equipment on a 23-year-old kid that's never flown an airplane, which brings us around to how 9/11 could not have been done by those young Muslims. Not because they're Muslims, but because they're young. They don't have the experience. The thing that hit the Pentagon after doing a 7,000-foot slice back to the right at 4 to 6 Gs, leveling out 15 feet above the ground and going 500 knots right through the window. Which window? Well, that's a question. There's 7,000 windows in that morning. Am I to believe, or are you guys going to believe much longer, that some Muslims with no experience that had never gone more than 250 knots can do a slice back at 5 Gs and find one window out of 7,000? No, I didn't think so. See, the whole world's coming awake. That's why Eric Holder wouldn't go to Oklahoma City. That's why Barack Obama, or whoever that maggot is, that's why he won't let the midshipmen carry bayonets or swords at inaugurations like they have from day one in the United States of America, which brings us around to the problem that you didn't ask about, David. But the problem starts and ends at quo warranto. Under whose authority have the 1,900-plus people been killed in Afghanistan since January 20th of 2009? How did you like my definition or my explanation of Air France, David?
Absolutely fabulous, Philip. And I would say in the last 20 minutes, we collectively, and you in particular with your knowledge, have solved the sabotage of Air France 447. In a manner that over all these years, all of these air traffic control authorities and experts have totally failed. So I think we can give ourselves a pat on the back. And in fact, what these two young pilots were the victims of was an electronic warfare attack. And who was the expert in electronic warfare at that time? Well, in Canada, it happened to be a man by the name of Russell Williams, who's a psychopathic pedophile behind bars for a double murder. So we have deeply corrupted and deeply compromised governments in the Five Eyes communities. And I've just did a little research while you were rabbiting on. Actually, that's not a fair description of that wonderful analysis field, and congratulations there. But I wanted to check that the traffic and terrain collision avoidance systems is not using forward-looking radar, and it isn't. It actually uses the digital signal from the transponder of the obstacle in the way of, well, in this case, Air France 447. So that was an artificially injected digital signal which spoofed or represented the characteristics of, well, it might be a CRJ or whatever it is in the way of Air France 447, but it could have actually been from an AWACS or an Air Force One or any other plane equipped to inject those kind of signals. And this is mass murder, Phil. Over to you.
Yes, I know that. In fact, I'm going to put out a challenge to the chat room. Now I see it. I'm trying to catch up with the chat room. I know Pat S. said maybe Field will look at the chat room so we can start answering these things. So for Pat Schreifels, wherever you are, apparently you're at home babysitting. If you could give me a question in the chat room, Pat, I'll try to answer it correctly. The mass murder, I just saw something. I've been trying to answer Joy, and apparently David interrupted my answer, but I must have answered Joy verbally. I think I did. In fact, so I just erased that. But as far as mass murder, I think that if we can total the number of people lost in Atomair 574, Kenya Airways 507, Air France 447, Sukhoi Superjet, and Malaysia 370. And I'm not so certain that the 239 souls who departed Kuala Lumpur on the evening of March 8th, I'm not so certain that they are deceased. but they are lost, as in we don't know where they are. And so I would challenge my brofro, homo, brofro, whatever he is, Eric Holder, why don't you retards in DOJ find out who's murdering all these people? And while you stick fingers in your bums collectively, I'm going to find out how many people were lost, whether they lost their life or just lost where they're located, in those five jets. And then I think I'll tell ALPA that $1 million apiece, and that would probably be, maybe there's 300 people in all those flights. Actually, no, there'd probably be more like 500. So if they would pay me $500 million, then I would cease and desist. Otherwise, I'll bring my lawsuit back, which is civil case 1:08-1600 parentheses RMC, which was dismissed without prejudice. And I'm not too smart, but scrutinizer might know if it's dismissed without prejudice, that leaves me the opportunity to bring it again, which I will. And each time I bring it, the price will go up. The case that I anticipate is going to come out of Malaysia over this MH370 deal, I think that's going to be the world's first $1 trillion lawsuit. And if ALPA were to wish that I'm not going to go right over to either the court in The Hague, if it's an international court there, if it's an international court in Montreal, I'd go there. If the case is going to be heard in Malaysia, I'd go there. If it's in Singapore, China, wherever the case is, I'll go there. And even though I probably would not wear my Frobro, in fact, there's a musical instrument called a Dobro, and I don't know how to play that, so I wouldn't bring that either. But all I have to bring to any courtroom anywhere in the world is the truth. And fortunately for me, what you and I have collectively been saying, David, since December 6th of 2006, and that was a Wednesday night, I think, somebody can check it, December 6th, 2006, we've been consistently saying that these nine aircraft, and we didn't say it all at once because they happened over a series of years, but United 175, United 93, American 11, American 77, Air France 447, Atom Air 574, Kenya Airways 507, Sukhoi Superjet, and Malaysia 370, all nine of those aircraft were taken but with remote capture by the Boeing Uninterruptible Autopilot. And right there, somebody's going to say, wait a minute, how can the Boeing Uninterruptible Autopilot cause Sukhoi to be lost? Real easy. Do your homework, I suggest, respectfully. See if maybe when Sukhoi asked to build that airplane, if they didn't accelerate the process and get a three-year head start on Bombardier by using Boeing patents. And part of the Boeing patent that Sukhoi borrowed, and that's done on a contractual basis, Boeing says, yeah, you can use our Boeing Uninterruptible Autopilot for X number of dollars. But then, you know, I'm going to make this name up. I probably found it in a 1953 phone book in the back of a 1954 Studebaker. Just a random name, Warren Buffett. What if Warren Buffett had a big investment in Bombardier and he saw that Sukhoi was 3 years ahead of Bombardier with absolutely identical jets? This hypothetical fat oaf might say, oh, my investment's at risk. I better make Sukhoi look incompetent. Gee, where have we heard this before? Malaysia. Oh, they're incompetent. No, they're not. The people that are incompetent include Eric Holder, Dianne Feinstein, Michael Bloomberg, John McCain. I said Eric Holder, but he deserves a double dose since I got my afro on, not to mention my game. Barry Sotero, Barack Munir Ubaid, or Barack Obama, whoever it is. The solution to the woes of the United States of America can be very, very simple. Drain the swamp, and you don't have to get all the crocodiles and cockroaches out. You get the five I mentioned earlier, and the rest will probably put in their retirement papers and say, don't worry about the retirement pay. If you'll just skip the rope and the blindfold, I'll retire for nothing. And the five people that I'd line up first and foremost would be the guy who we don't know what his name is, Eric Holder, maybe John Roberts or John McCain, one of the others. And then the fat woman from San Francisco, that she thinks she can have a gun, but we can't. Well, I don't know what her name is, Dianne Fine something. Dianne, why don't you find me in Wisconsin and may the best man win? And then, of course, we always want to keep my sister's name in the headlights, and that's headlights, not headlice. See, I don't have any headlice. The guy I skinned to get this might have headlice, but what Ginger Cookie's always complaining about, these objects in my Fro-Bro, those are actually peanut husk or residue of peanut husk, and they come from the floor of JR's bar, which I might add, let me just get updated, I'll give it right back to you. But for the people who come to the Plum Plunge, we have selected, out of the hundreds of bars in Plum City, we've selected JR's Main Street Bar as the, here it comes folks, the official bar of Plum Plunge 2014. And of course, when you go there, you can either use these koozies, or if you want like mineral water or carrot juice, you can use one of these shot glasses. And of course, we have a bunch of free drink coupons, and I'm not suggesting that people drink anything they don't normally drink. For instance, if you like to drink milk and water, these are milk and water tickets. They cost people nothing, and they get you anything you want at JR's. And somebody said, well, you only have 200 tickets. These tickets can be used endlessly during the Plum City Plunge, beginning with the first arrivals, which I think will be Jack Mack on the boys' team and Sherlock on the girls' team. But what happens was, I guess I was being a cheapskate. I had 200 tickets printed, but think of it as 2,000, because every morning I'll go into JR's when he opens, and I'll say, JR, how many tickets you get last night? He'll say, I got 7 or I got 300. No, you can't get more than 200. So I'll just buy the tickets back and I'll redistribute them. And why am I doing that? I'm not doing it to encourage people to drink something they don't normally drink. In other words, we have plenty of teetotalers at Able Danger. That's okay. They have mineral water, they have pop, they have iced tea. By special order, they can get milk or anything you want. And all of those would be available for one of these tickets. And the tickets will never run out, because every morning I'll go buy them back. So, David, what did I answer, and did it satisfy your quest for knowledge?
Kind of, but I want you to add and always lock in this name into the people you need to target, and that's Maureen Baginski. Let me just give a quick summary. Maureen Baginski probably was a charter member of the United States Senior Executive Service with your sister Christine Marcy. So they launched this parasitical bureaucracy with about now today 9,000 bureaucrats, senior bureaucrats with a civilian status equivalent to an admiral or a general, that run the United States government. My guess is the majority of those people have been compromised through the pedophile blackmail racket run out of Chicago by Obama and Sheraton Hotels. And so they can be relied upon by the criminal group behind them to do exactly what they're told. Now, it's 12:22, so I'll just read the third paragraph in the post that went out today. McConnell, 30-year airline and 20-year, two-year military pilot with 23,000 hours of safety, has booked a session on the U-Fly simulator to demonstrate the probable route taken by the hijacked aircraft and a Cat 3C landing with the Boeing uninterruptible autopilot on the British Indian Ocean territory of Diego Garcia. So I've got a question for you, Phil, to ask. Now, this is a sort of detective Sherlock Holmes type question, and it will be exceedingly interesting to see the body language of the guy who probably tells you he's not going to give you the answer. But the question is to the owner of the U-Fly facility, about 5-minute taxi drive from the Sheraton Gateway at Toronto, is to ask to see the logbook of his operation on March the 8th. And can I throw over to you, Field, why that might have some important names on it?
Yeah, sure. But it's quite possible that if somebody wanted to control the cockpit of Malaysia 370, they could do it from that simulator. Is that where you're going with this, David?
Absolutely. And all the evidence suggests that that simulator was hooked through to air traffic control at Toronto Airport, and one or more of the rooms occupied by guests of the Sheraton Gateway Hotel which would have put them in contact with the MOD, the United Kingdom Ministry of Defence Skynet satellite communications, Obama's Red Switch network, and given them real-time access to a backdoor into the Boeing uninterruptible autopilot of MH Flight 370. Over to you.
Okay, I'm just watching some of the stuff going on in the chat room, and I think I'm going to try to go a different direction now and say that rather than have all these different sideshow arguments going on, I think what we should all do is try to figure out what we can do best in our 1 hour of simulator time this week. It's hard to believe it's this week already, because this is a direct question to you, David. When did this whole idea of doing a simulator first pop into your mind? It's only been 3 or 4 days, hasn't it?
As soon as I saw the wag the dog shit being generated by CNN, and someone sent me that video of Martin Savage, who's born of British parents in La Chine, Quebec, who was on holiday on March the 8th in Australia, and how he got brought back by CNN and sent up to Toronto. I believe he checked into the Sheraton Gateway Hotel. That would be interesting to look at their guest registration book. And then he would spend between 12 and 18 hours a day in that simulator with a guy called Mitchell Cadoba, I think that was his name, who's a amateur pilot of small aircraft. And these two, between them, dredged up these ridiculous scenarios about what might have happened to MH370 and sent it, effectively sent the public and various dumb leaders like Tony Abbott of Australia hunting in the deepest part of the Indian Ocean. I thought, well, wouldn't it be fantastic if we booked the same simulator and instead of locking out the media, we put you with your 23,000 hours, and judging by the way your fluency with the argument and the language and the jargon that you gave us with Air France 447, you're going to kill them, Phil. Go for it. Over to you.
Oh, I'm not going to kill anybody that's not being dishonest. The truth is what's going to prevail. And see, the beauty of my position, and I think by extension, if anybody in Malaysia or that area needs an expert witness, I'm fine. They don't have to look very far to find one. And I don't mean this in a boastful way, but for 7.5 years, going back to December 10th of 2006, you and I have had a consistent message. And the message is that the Boeing uninterruptible autopilot is in fact an illegal modification because the pilots operating the aircraft don't know about it. In Boeing's own nomenclature, it says that the Boeing uninterruptible autopilot can be triggered by any of the pilots in the cockpit, and that the switch for the autopilot is in an inconspicuous place. I don't know if that's true or false, but they've had the Boeing uninterruptible autopilot Boeing aircraft going back to 1995, and the period between 1995 and when I flew my last flight over in Kazakhstan in 2009, I never knew where the switch was for the Boeing or Thales uninterruptible autopilot. Now, I've already used Boeing's own words, perhaps against Boeing, not intentionally. Airbus, they've created a case for themselves too. Airbus Industries has boasted that the A320 is the first aircraft that is delivered from the factory with the capability of being flown remotely. That's interesting. So in 1989, these Airbus 320s came out of the factory in Toulouse, and they were wired to be flown remotely. Okay, well, from 1999 to 2009, in that 10-year period, I flew the A320 for Northwest Airlines and the A320 and the A321 and the A319 for Air Astana, which is the national airline of Kazakhstan. And in that 11-year period, 99 to 2009, while I was in the world's first droned aircraft, factory droned aircraft, using Airbus's own words, I never knew that there was a button that's inconspicuous in the cockpit that I could push to trigger the remote control of my aircraft. Me, that's not a boastful, possessive my aircraft. The captain of any airliner flies a dispatch release. And when you sign your name on that release, you basically own the aircraft until you get out of it at your destination or an alternate airport, wherever you safely land that with all of your passengers. And then the passengers walk by the cockpit one by one and said, thanks, it's a great flight. Sometimes they don't get a walk by the cockpit and say that was a bad landing or a great flight because you're deader than a doornails because of the uninterruptible autopilots or the irreversible autopilots that none of the pilots know about. So what you can anticipate, David, is that some co-pilot, and I'm hoping that it's our own Agent Sherlock, I hope she'll be able to get time off from what she needs to do in another part of Canada and show up. And I have total confidence in our producer, who I've never met, whose initials are Juliet Bravo. I have total confidence that everything he's told us is accurate. I think that his motivation is to get the truth out. I think a further motivation is I think he would like to get the Able Danger name onto a 5 or 6 episode TV series. But once we peel enough onion layers away to get rid of Barry Sotero, Eric Holder, Christine Marcy, John McCain,
Maureen Baginski,
Jamie Gorelick, Hillary Clinton, well, pretty much everybody in Congress except for Michelle Bachmann and Trey Gowdy and Ted Cruz and Justin Amash. And I'm not so sure about Rand Paul because I'm not a political person, but I'm leaving out another Cuban. There's three, Stephen Stockwood of Texas. There's some really good people. There's a good guy in Oklahoma, come to think of it. There might be two good guys in Oklahoma, because when some senator from Oklahoma has his son die in a plane crash, it's almost as if somebody who doesn't like good senators is trying to get your attention. And if somebody wants to get my attention, good luck, because I have severe attention deficit disorder. And if Hillary or Holder or my sister or the guy with no name want my attention, they can just buzz off and kiss my ass. Over to you, David.
But yeah, and talking about Sheraton's role in this, they, with their sister hotels in the Starwood chain, W and Westin, they have over 2,000 hotels around the world, which is an extraordinary, enormous chain. But it just struck me that there is a Sheraton at Heathrow Airport that would probably be responsible for switching the engines off that Boeing 777 as it was coming into land, and a brilliant bit of flying, I assume it was brilliant, by the captain, managed to save that aircraft. And I think he did what you implied, put the nose down and reduce the drag over the wing flips, and he got himself an extra 180 feet. So he got clear of the barrier or boundary fence, and he landed on the strip, even though it shook the place up a bit. But just putting in, I think it's nearly time to go, but I'll just read out the last paragraph of today's post. McConnell has been directed by Able Danger Global to select witnesses to the upcoming U-Fly simulation who may wish to sue for damages in Ree Serco's apparent role in staging MH370 cross keys takeoff from Kuala Lumpur and a Category 3C landing in Diego Garcia. So I wish you all of the best, Field. I think it's going to be an extraordinarily dramatic 1 hour. And I imagine that the production that we get out of that, if all goes to plan, we can anticipate watching that through Able Danger globally. And I think it's going to be a shattering experience for the bad guys. Over to you.
Oh, yeah. They're already scared. Because, see, what we do is we publish what we're going to do. Then we go do it. And then we talk about what we did. So if you want to end the show here fairly soon, that's fine with me. I was up earlier this morning putting in an hour with Joyce Riley. And if somebody has that link handy to Joyce Riley's archive show of tomorrow's show, would you please put it up for anybody who has not seen it or heard it? Because the comments I got from people, well, in this chat room earlier here, about 5 or 10 minutes before the show went live, somebody was saying that was a good interview. Someone else has called me and said that was a good interview. I've posted it to abledanger.net. If somebody has that link handy, feel free to post it here. And I want to address a question from Pat S. It said, stepped away, so if Field hadn't answered, here it is once more. What did John Lennon, Elvis, and Michael Jackson have in common? Later in their careers, they all developed a social conscience. In the case of Elvis, he wanted to get out of rock and roll and go to gospel. and the powers that be dissuaded him from doing that. John Lennon, his conscience was getting to the level of he wanted to share with the world as a 40-year-old ex-Beatle who it was that bankrolled the Beatles, and perhaps he was going to express the opinion that their unintended effect was the moral degradation of the United States of America's young people to some degree. I think most of us have a human nature which is not morally sound, and most of us try to control that to a large degree. Can everybody control it completely to a complete degree? I don't think so. I don't know. That's for each of us to answer. But anyway, the point is for Pat and anyone else that's interested, those three gentlemen developed a social conscience, and the people that run the world, and the people that run the world are the people who signed off on having Malaysia 370 electronically captured, dare I say snatched. Oops, I guess I dare. That aircraft was snatched right out of the control of the captain and the co-pilot and the dispatcher from Malaysia 370. And it's going to be my distinct pleasure. Right now in Toronto, it's Monday and it's 3:35. At 3:35 Thursday, 72 hours from right now, my smiling face with probably fluffier hair because I'll shampoo and probably I'll shave, which I do a couple times a month. And I'll try to look somewhat professional, and I will not have an afro, and I will not act like a wise-ass teenager. I'll go in there and act like somebody who has been in interesting situations in airplanes. And if anybody wants to read about an interesting situation that occurred on the 13th of December of 2008, where the Airbus that I was in, I wasn't flying it at first, but when we became out of control on takeoff and the co-pilot was overwhelmed with what's going on, then I had to do some pilot stuff real fast or we would have crashed for sure. Whether you're injured or dead, doesn't matter. The point is, don't go there. Don't crash in the first place. Well, that's my attitude. That's always been my attitude as a pilot. We used to say things like pilot and command. You can't say that anymore because with the flip of the uninterruptible auto switch, the pilot is no longer in command. Maybe that's my final statement. David, do you want to have the last word?
Yeah, I just see a few little comments there. Sheraton Hotels are part of the corporate network of global control. I'd just like to emphasize that in 1978, a RICO, a racketeering influenced and corrupt organization called the Master Inholders, was set up by the late Alexander Haig at a Bilderberg conference in Princeton, New Jersey, or near Princeton, together with Nicholas Soames. And these 100 or so general managers of the world's greatest hotel chains have formed a cartel, and I went to see the film again last night for the second time, The Society of the Crossed Keys, and basically my allegation would be they're operating a global pedophile blackmail operation where the most powerful people in the world are cycled through these hotels, encounter a child, are filmed and recorded and then blackmailed to order to keep silent in the case of, for example, the hijacking that we see with MH370 on March the 8th. So God bless you, Field, and may you succeed beyond your wildest dreams on Thursday. Over to you.
Yeah, I whatever happens Thursday is going to be a shot in the arm for Malaysia. It's going to be a full frontal attack against CNN and also the Australian fat oaf that his candy ass was in a simulator making all sorts of wrong assumptions. And note to self, perhaps one of the dangerettes will remind me, I need to review the Australian hit piece on the Malaysian airline and watch the guy that was in the left seat of that 777 simulator made at least six fundamentally flawed presumptions, none of which were in the favor of Malaysia for Malaysia Airlines or the crew of that evening's flight 370 to Beijing. And I'm going to make sure that when we're in the simulator, whoever we is, here's how many we's I know. I see the red button. Thank you, Matza. So you tell me 3, 2, 1, push it. I'll comply. But we're going to have two professional cameramans. We're going to have the producer. We're going to have a co-pilot. We're going to have someone pretending to be a captain, and the simulator technician would probably be outside the simulator, but that's going to be sort of a crowd, so that's who's going to be in there. Everything we do is going to be honest and heartfelt and spontaneous, and because you don't need a script to go fly a flight, all you need is an aircraft to dispatch, relief, some fuel, and a reason to get airborne, and that's what we're going to do in the simulator. And I'm going to hope that we have a finished product, not necessarily a polished product, but I'm hoping that within hours of getting out of the simulator, we can at least have a first draft of a video, because it's going to be my pleasure to provide that to Joyce Riley and my contacts in Malaysia, Singapore, Vietnam, and Thailand area of operations. Having said that, if anybody hasn't heard the Joyce Riley interview, it's about 40 minutes long, and she corrects me at one point. She says, well, I don't know what pedophilia has to do with these false flags. And that was a legitimate question. Oh, thank you, Ginger. That was quick. She reminded, and I'll see that too, because I'll review this this afternoon and tonight. I'm not going to write another chapter before I leave because it's too much pressure. And there's nothing significant. Well, I'll write one if Harry Calder steps down or Obama declares what gender that thing that he rooms with is. Otherwise,